Hello everyone and welcome to the second Vodcast in the Electrochemistry Unit as per the way I teach it to my AP Chemistry students. For some of you out there in college, this might actually be really Vodcast number one for the Electrochem Unit because, you know, the first Vodcast was just based on oxidation reduction. So now that we've kind of revisited redox, now we're going to start to apply that redox reaction idea in order to identify the different parts of the galvanic cell. New word alert coming your way right there. And also throughout this Vodcast, I'm going to try and hopefully explain to you how the actual galvanic cell works and lead us right up into this idea of chemical potential, aka cell potential, aka the voltage of the cell. But we're not going to get into how we actually calculate that in this Vodcast. If that's what you're looking for, you want to skip this Vodcast and get into Vodcast number three. So without further ado, here we go, right? So with the last Vodcast, I actually really went over this idea of oxidation reduction, right? We looked at the oxidation and reduction involved with the permanganate ion with iron 2. That iron 2 is going to go from 2 up to 3. We balance it based off the number of electrons, so I would have multiplied that by 5, and we would have had our oxidation and our reduction, right? So as we went over previously, this is only going to occur if manganese could actually accept those 5 electrons, which means that each iron would have to shoot off one. So if those 5 irons could donate those 5 electrons that manganese needs in order to be reduced, this reaction will occur. And so with this, we notice that when this reaction actually occurs, it's actually very, very exothermic. And so if heat is going to be released, really heat is just another form of energy, right? And energy can be sound, it can be light, it can be heat, it can be maybe even electrical. So as a scientific community, we started to ask ourselves this major question right here, right? How can we harness this phenomenon that certain reactions, double replacement, single replacement, synthesis, might actually have this insane amount of energy being released, and better yet, this energy being released while electrons are being transferred? And so the here we go, right? So the idea was that if we were to actually separate these two species and have the oxidation occurring in one side and the reduction occurring in another, and if we connect them via a wire, because of that sea of electrons that metals have and that freedom of electrons that metals have, perhaps we could harness that electrical energy and we can harness that transfer of electrons. And that's all electricity is. Electricity is just electrons jumping from one spot to another to another to another, very much like dominoes. And so this was the forefront, this was the basis for everything that we now know and we call a battery. And so the first ever battery is actually what's called the galvanic cell. And a galvanic cell is set up as you see right here to the right. Now you may notice that there's a little bit of, like, you know, some photoshopping done in here. I've removed the part on purpose. I'm gonna actually have you kind of sketch in your notes a very similar version of this on the next slide in a matter of moments. So what we thought was, okay, well, if I have some oxidation going on in one cell and I have some reduction going on in another cell. So what our early chemistry forefathers, what they did was they took a solution, they put this thing called a cathode or an electrode in there, and they put another solution in a different beaker with a different cathode, a different electrode. And on paper, we thought that, you know, oxidation might occur in one compartment, reduction would occur in another compartment. And if we just connect them via this wire, and if we just let the electrons flow from one beaker into the other, as you can see via this picture, and if those electrons do in fact flow, if there is this thing called oxidation, the release of electrons and reduction, the accepting of electrons, electrons should move through the wire. And so our chemistry forefathers, they set this all up, and as soon as they set it up, bang, all of a sudden, whoa, we have this movement of electrons. We have these electrons actually being transferred. The hypothesis, the thought that we had was true, and the electrons are being transferred, and we see this jolt of electricity and this jolt of energy. But the problem was, as soon as we connected these cells, as soon as the electricity started to flow, it immediately then stopped flowing. And what we started to notice was, okay, so this does work in theory, but as soon as it starts, it kind of, oops, sorry, as soon as it started, it was kind of ending. And what we realized was that what was happening is, as soon as we connected these two cells via a piece of wire, the electrons were flowing from the left to the right, and the electrons were leaving the oxidation site and going to the reduction site. But the problem was, now all of a sudden we have this huge buildup of electrons. So now as these fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, hundredth, whatever electrons are starting to flow, as they start to come in and there's this huge buildup of electrons, remember, like charges repel. So as these electrons are coming in and seeing all these other electrons, they're going, whoa, whoa, wait a minute, screw that. I don't want to go. I don't want to come into this other cell. And so the flow of electrons actually stopped because of this huge resistance. Okay, so as our forefathers, you know, hypothesized that this was an actual thing, that we could actually build and harness those moving electrons accordingly, and as soon as they realized, oh my God, it did work, but it stopped immediately, they sat there and they pondered over it, how can we fix this and how can we get this to be continuous? And they actually came up with an ingenious idea. As they said, well, as long as we can find a way, remember, all these electrons are going to be building up and building up and building up and building up. And as long as we find a way to somehow negate these electrons and get rid of these negatives, the electrons would always want to leave this zinc compartment and continue to flow through the wire, through the limit, as Kanye even said back in the day, through the wire. As these electrons want to even continue to flow through, if there was no buildup of electrons here, if I can get rid of these electrons somehow, the flow would continue, and therefore we would have this thing called electricity. We'd have this constant flow of electrons. So what our chemistry forefathers, what they thought of and what they came up with was this amazing idea of what is called a salt bridge. And so a salt bridge, it's pretty simplistic in its idea, but man, the actual execution of how the salt bridge works is pretty ingenious, and it does usually kind of trip some students up. So what they did was they decided to put in this U-shaped YouTube, not the YouTube you're watching this on right now, the old school YouTube, an actual U, or a tube that's in the shape of the U. And what we did was we filled that with an electrolyte, and that electrolyte helped kind of cancel out those different buildup of negatives here and really a buildup of positives over here as well. Now we've since, as you know, technology gets better, our technology gets better. So we've also actually came up with another form of allowing this to happen, and we'll actually look at this in class, what it actually looks like. But we could either connect it via this YouTube so that the charges could continually transfer and cancel each other out, or we came up with this idea of what's called a porous disk. So you can imagine, for my bio nerds out there, a membrane that's going to allow the electrons, the buildup of electrons that form in this copper side, to actually flow through and find the buildup of positives that we're going to find on this side, because those opposites attract. And so we will keep that neutrality that we need so that these electrons can continue to flow. All right, so now looking at the real legit buildup and the actual real legit setup for a galvanic cell, here we have it, nice and big, nice and zoomed up. So I'm going to pause it via Edpuzzle here and require you, or ask you, to try and write this down, because they have asked in the past, they will ask you in the past, to either deconstruct one of these diagrams or even build one from scratch. So you need to be able to draw this. All right, so now that we have this galvanic cell diagram or picture in our notes, let's start to break it down, right? So what we actually have is, in both of these two different compartments, in these two different cells within the galvanic cell itself, we have these things called electrodes. Electrodes are always going to be made of a pure sample, and usually some sort of metal. And the electrode, actually, believe it or not, usually matches the actual, what we call the electrolytic solution that it's placed within, right? So I have a pure piece of zinc that I'm placing into a zinc sulfate solution, and I have a pure piece of copper that's placed into the copper 2 sulfate solution. Now, these on their own are actually what are called electrodes. We're going to hone in further as to why one's called the anode and one's called the cathode in a matter of moments. But again, as I had mentioned, we actually put them in what's called an electrolytic solution. So the zinc electrode is actually put in zinc sulfate, but really what's in here are a bunch of zinc ions. The sulfate is really just a spectator ion. So in this, and this is why it has this little bit of a purplish look to it, are a bunch of zinc always takes a plus 2 charge, a bunch of zinc ions. Now, conversely or similarly, the copper electrode placed into a copper 2 sulfate solution, which really, again, the sulfate is just going to be a spectator ion, so really with just a bunch of copper 2 ions. Now, there's a reason for that. The reason is so that we can actually help transfer those electrons, and again, that common ion thing we discussed early in the year. Now, the purpose of the salt bridge, and I had kind of mentioned earlier, it's very simple in its idea, but it's actually very, very complex, although it's not really that complex in actuality. So usually salt bridges are filled with different electrolytic solutions that are not involved in the actual reaction. So something like potassium nitrate, potassium chloride, sodium nitrate, sodium chloride. And so really in my salt bridge, I have a huge variety of these ions, right? So if I have a bunch of potassium nitrate that I've put into my salt bridge, I have a bunch of potassiums and a bunch of nitrates. And so again, what the whole idea of how an electrolytic cell works is that the electrons are going to leave one compartment. Actually, they leave what's called the anode. They're going to leave the area where the oxidation is occurring, and they're going to go to the area where the reduction is occurring. Now, as we were saying earlier, in theory, these galvanic cells worked perfectly, and they do work without a actual salt bridge, but they work only for the matter of mere moments. So the salt bridge, what it does is it helps negate this buildup of negatives, and conversely, a buildup of positives that are going to occur in the anode compartment or the oxidation compartment accordingly. So since I'm building up at the electrode where the oxidation is occurring, I'm building up a bunch of positives because I'm going to become more positive. That's why, again, after all, it is what's called oxidation that's occurring over here. So to kind of counteract and counterbalance all these buildups of positives, the nitrates in the salt bridge, the negatives, are going to start to find their way through the salt bridge and work into this electrolytic solution to negate these extra positives that I have built up. And the potassiums in the salt bridge, they're going to leave the salt bridge and they're going to jump into the electrode where the reduction is occurring to help counterbalance all of these positive electrons that we have and that we're building up due to the transfer of electrons from this electrode to that electrode. And so it's through the donation of this salt bridge that allows our overall cell to stay neutral overall and not build up these charges. And so the electrons will continue to transfer until I either run out of one of the electrodes, one of the electrolytic solutions, or until I use up all of the different ions within the salt bridge itself. All right, so with that, I kind of just verbally went over this, but just again, to kind of hit you with this for one last formal time, right? So the idea is that if we can harness oxidation is becoming more positive, it's the releasing of your electrons, it's the increase of your actual oxidation state. So if the electrons are going to leave the zinc compartment and go towards the copper compartment, if I have a wire hooked up here, those movements of electrons, that is what's called electricity. So as these electrons flow from the oxidation or the left to the reduction or the right compartment, what actually starts to happen, which is really, really crazy here, is this electrode here, this zinc, it actually starts to dissolve. The zinc solid undergoes oxidation. It becomes zinc 2 plus, which is aqueous, and it releases those 2 moles of electrons. So as that does, or as this occurs, what's actually very interesting is that this zinc electrode is going to actually deteriorate and get smaller and smaller over time and create more and more of these zinc ions in this electrolytic solution. That's why we need to donate those nitrate ions from the salt bridge in order to counterbalance all of these new positives. So actually what happens is that this electrode actually starts to deteriorate. It actually gets smaller and smaller in mass over time. And this is why batteries will eventually die, quote unquote die, because we'll eventually run out of our electrode or the electrolytic solution in the cathode or our actual salt bridge. And so the zinc electrode actually disappears because it's going from solid zinc into this aqueous. It doesn't disappear. It's that the mass actually goes into the electrolytic solution. And conversely, in the reduction compartment here, all of these copper 2 ions that were in solution in our copper 2 sulfate, they actually get attracted to these buildup of electrons. And so these copper 2 ions that are in solution, they actually get attracted to, and they actually undergo what we would write the half cell of reduction. They actually become solid copper. And so whereas this electrode actually gets smaller and smaller over time, this electrode actually gets what I call like hairy. This electrode actually starts to grow and precipitates out more and more pure solid. So this electrode actually gets bigger and bigger, but the electrolytic solution in this compartment loses its plus ions. And so that's why those potassium ions in the salt bridge have to donate themselves to become more regenerated. So you can see that, and it's explained over here. Now, it turns out that the compartment that the oxidation is occurring is always what's called the anode, aka we designate that with a minus because that's where the electrons are coming from. So if you've ever actually looked at a battery, The side that has the minus or the negative side on it, that's actually what we call the anode. That's where the oxidation is actually occurring. That's where the electrons are originating from, and they're leaving and they're going towards the side that is positive, aka what it's attracted to, aka what we call the cathode. And so the cathode is where the reduction always occurs. Now, a little like mnemonic device to try and remember that is an ox, for the anode is where the oxidation occurs. And red cat, they're the best friends. Anox and red cat are best friends. The red cat is where the reduction is actually occurring, which is at the cathode. And they do expect you to know that over time, the anode dissolves and gets smaller, and the cathode grows and gets larger. And so, it dissolving is an indication that that's actually oxidation occurring, and the growing or the gaining in mass is an indication where reduction is occurring. Okay, so why are we learning about these things called galvanic cells, and why is this part of electrochemistry, right? Well, it's that pull. It's actually the pull and the need of this anode to actually, well, flip the script here on you. I put the copper on the left side, which is perfectly fine. But it's the pull. It's copper's want for these electrons. It's its want to be reduced and pull these electrons through the wire from the zinc electrode, which is where the oxidation is occurring, to that copper electrode where the reduction is actually going to occur. It's that actual pull of the red cat, of the cathode, that actually is the driving force for this thing called the battery. So it's this pull or this driving force that we know and that we are able to measure by connecting what's called a voltmeter in line with this circuit that is created via the wire. It's that pull, or it's that driving force that we actually call the potential of the cell, and we're actually able to put a number to that, which is going to be what the next podcast is all about. So, the electrical potential of a cell is that pull, is its ability to draw that voltage, to pull those electrons towards it. We can actually hook up a voltmeter to measure that. Now, for a matter of pure, being honest here, very similar to a calorimeter, as much as a calorimeter helps us measure the actual amount of energy that is being absorbed or released by a reaction, realize that there is going to be a little bit of electricity, a little bit of voltage that goes into this voltmeter that's going to be lost. So I might put 10 volts or 10 electrons through, and maybe 9.9 of them make it out because a little bit of energy is going to be powered or you're going to be used to power the voltmeter. So if we really wanted the true value of this thing called the cell potential, we would want to use a potentiometer in order to actually measure, which is just really a really, really low current, really, really low voltage voltometer. It's only going to absorb a little bit. So these are how galvanic cells work. They do expect you to be able to discuss what the anode is, what the cathode is, what signs one gets bigger, one gets smaller in terms of mass and size, and why and how the electrons are transferred. In the next podcast, we'll get into what we can do with the math. So hope this podcast helped you identify the different parts of a galvanic cell, and hopefully you're able to draw the different parts and discuss the different parts. Thanks for watching.